And we are rolling on March 24th here at UCLA, where we are hearing impromptu speeches. It's a beautiful day at UCLA. The sunshine is shining. What else would it do? And we're about to hear David Gottlieb, with two T's, address the question, if it's the right chair, it doesn't take too long to get comfortable in it, by Robert De Niro. I repeat, if it's the right chair, it doesn't take too long to get comfortable in it.
Whenever you guys are ready.
We be ready, David.
Hello, everyone. My name is David Gottlieb.
Hi, David.
And today I'm going to start out by telling you about two UCLA students, two freshmen. These girls are tall. These girls are Kobe tall. Two of the tallest girls to ever, definitely in their freshman class. Their names are Jenny and Claire. And they did the same extracurricular in high school. They both played volleyball. They're going to be roommates. It's going to be, this on paper sounds like a very good time. This is not what happened. I talked to their coach. He told me these people are not going to be friends. It's just not going to work. Anyway, a lot more on Jenny and Claire later. But for now, what I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk to you about the Robert De Niro quote, "If it is the right chair, it shouldn't take too long to get comfortable in it." Now, personally, I don't like this quote. I don't think it's a very good quote because I kind of reject the notion of a comfortable chair. I think that there's a lot more to learn from discomfort, a lot more area for growth in discomfort than there is in comfort. So I'm gonna tell you three different stories. I'm gonna tell you the story of Daniel Rosica, a walk-on catcher at UCLA. I'm going to tell you the story of Eric Felia, an outfielder at UCLA. I'm gonna tell you the story of Sven Nader, a basketball back in the day at UCLA. You might wonder, why do I know so much about these UCLA athletes? I'll give you a little bit about my credibility. I'm an assistant sports editor at the Daily Bruin. I spend many hours a week making sure that the stories of UCLA students get told. Anyway, why does this matter to any of you? Well, I think that I'm hoping to hit kind of close to home today because I'm going to be talking a lot about UCLA students. I'm going to be talking a lot about people just like you and how they've worked their way through uncomfortable chairs to find something that was actually very positive. Anyway, so starting off, Daniel Rosica. This guy was a smart kid, probably a similar GPA to any of you. Not particularly tall, not particularly strong. I think I've probably got 2 inches and 20 pounds on him, and I'm a non-athlete myself. But they thought he would make a good bullpen catcher. Coach John Savage, he made some calls to people he trusted, and he thought, this guy, he's a smart kid. He played a little bit of high school baseball. He'll be good for us. And so he did. He spent a whole year in the bullpen. He was told he was never going to play. He was told maybe you'll play senior year, and that's an uncomfortable chair. Literally, he's squatting down in this uncomfortable chair all the time. Just stuck in the bullpen, never getting any glory. It's all about just sort of, being there and trying to help people. But you know what happened? His sophomore year, well, I guess it was technically his redshirt freshman year, but that's a technicality. His second year at UCLA, both catchers were out. One got injured, one quit, and all of a sudden he was the guy. And he ended up having a pretty darn good year. He ended up hitting a lot better than a lot of other of the players. And he's the starting catcher this year. He's number one on the depth chart this year. He did his time. He went through that uncomfortable chair, and he made it through. Now, the second guy I'm going to tell you about is a guy who was in way too comfortable in the chair. This guy's Eric Felia. This guy was on top of the world for a little bit. He was in the College World Series in 2013. He was hitting. He won the thing. His girlfriend was on TV. I mean, this guy was doing great. But if you ask John Savage what he thought about it, the same baseball coach I was telling you about, he was saying, this guy's trending in the wrong direction. You can kind of tell he's kind of a white liar type of guy. And it caught up with him. This comfortable chair of winning it, he ended up, what happened was he got caught for plagiarism on a philosophy paper. And so he ended up having, he lost his academic eligibility. He was kind of lost for option. And he took a couple of years. He took a year off because he was injured, and another year off because of the academic ineligibility. Worked some odd jobs, ended up working at the Playboy Mansion. And then finally, as a 23-year-old, that's old for college baseball, he approached John Savage and he said, "I'm thinking about coming back." And Savage, didn't take it lightly, but really the reasons that he was able to take Filia back was because he could tell that he had kind of been a changed guy. He could tell at that time, in that uncomfortable chair where baseball had been taken away from him, baseball, one of the things he loves most, that was something that ended up being productive for him. And when he came back, he ended up having an incredible season, an incredible redshirt senior season for UCLA as an old player. He just actually put together one of the best minor league seasons of, you know, any of the players in his draft class. So he ended up, you know, pushing through that uncomfortable time, and it ended up working out for him, even though it did take him a little bit longer. And then the last story that I'm going to tell you about, if I can remember what it is the story of Swen Nader. Now, Swen Nader was a guy, this guy's big. This guy's 6'11", very, very talented basketball player. But he was here during the John Wooden era, and John Wooden didn't think that the best thing for him was going to be to play Swen Nader. He thought that Swen Nader's best, you know, chair, if we're going to continue the metaphor, was actually going to be just as a practice player, just to develop Bill Walton, who I'm sure we're all familiar with, is an incredible, you know, had an incredible basketball career and is now having a little bit of fun as an announcer as well. But that's what Swen Nader did his entire career at UCLA. This guy was one of the best athletes on the team, one of the, you know, most physical specimen type guys, and he didn't play pretty much the entire time. But you know what? John Wooden takes care of his own. He's a good guy, and he made sure that Nader got looked at by NBA scouts. He made sure that Nader was going to get a chance, and he ended up being a first-round pick in the NBA, even though he had never played before in his whole life, in an actual game, or at least not played regularly in actual game time. And so I think that what you can see is that from these three stories, these are guys that dealt with very uncomfortable chairs. I mean, you know, I'm going to finish that story about Jenny and Claire from the beginning. You know, right at the beginning, you know, those two players, they ended up having a tough time. You know, and they had to really fight with each other. And they were, you know, they played the same position. They were hitting against each other, or blocking each other every day in practice. And it was all out brawl. But by the end, by their, you know, sort of juniors and senior seasons, when they settled into their roles, when they pushed through that uncomfortable time, they ended up being really, really good. And it was just sort of the way that, you know, Michael Seeley, the women's volleyball coach, put it to me was that it was the true spirit of, you know, competition and working together for the better of the program. So I'm just going to say there should be little doubt in this room that, you know, an uncomfortable chair, no matter what the famous actor Robert De Niro says, it maybe isn't the best thing. And I think that maybe we should all take a minute when we see ourselves in a more uncomfortable environment to really appreciate the opportunities for growth that are presented to us in that kind of situation. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time. I hope that I was informative and helpful to you all. Have a great spring break.
Mm-hmm.
Time was
6:21. Thank you, David.
What do you like?
I liked how...
Name?
Hi, I'm Josh.
Hi, Josh.
Hello. I liked how, with your credentials beforehand, I could really see how your facts came really into play. It seemed like a lot of backhand knowledge that you probably might have worked on before, so it was really good incorporating it into... What I thought in the beginning was like a real curveball of a quote, so it was really cool to see you like really put in like things that you are already accustomed to. That was a good speech.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Improvement. Hi, my name is Serena.
Hi, Serena.
I mean, I thought it was really cool how you had three similar examples of UCLA athletes because you're incredible in that. But I thought it might be cool to also mix it up. But I understand the approach, and I thought it was also pretty interesting. So. Mm-hmm. Just being nitpicky.
Example from another world, history,
right,
or politics.
Right. But that's just being,
yeah,
like nitpicky. I thought it was really good.
Yeah, you know, variety is the spice of life. Okay, good. Thank you for that. David, I liked your approach. I didn't know what you were going to do with the Robert De Niro quote, and you did a marvelous thing with it. You disagreed with it. And, you could have taken the other approach about, you know, people being in their comfort zones and different areas, but you took it more metaphorically, and that was good. So you told us about these two women volleyball players that were at each other's throats, and then you tied back to that, so you clearly understood the concept of the grabbing intro and good tie back. Your thesis preview was good. You told us where you were going to go, and You sold it to the audience, why it was significant to them. I'm not sure I bought it, but at least you tried. It's hard, Not every. And so you had three stories from sports, and I won't belabor the point that, you know, in real competition, in impromptu competition, the judges would clearly knock points off for not having a variety of examples. But I think in your case, and not being in official competition, that you did something smart. You went with what you knew, and that's a good thing to do, you know. Generally, as a starting point, good writers go beyond what they know, and they learn new things and other things like that. But, you know, it was good. So your first story was of Daniel, the catcher that was left in the bullpen, and then fate intervened and he got to come out and play and did well, and he's now the starting catcher. And I like the way that you went back to the chair metaphor in your explanation of Daniel. So you didn't just say, oh, here was Daniel, and tell a story and not relate it to what your thesis was about the chair. So that was good. On the second story of Eric, sad story. I've had examples of this in my 40 years here, and it's always sad to see when someone thinks they can cut that corner. And the school's pretty good now at ferreting out people that plagiarize, you know. So, but it shows there are second acts and second chances, and so I like that story. And so, and you did relate it to the comfort of the chair, and that was good. Swan story, I like the way you didn't portray John Wooden in the end as a total a-hole, using somebody to prime Bill Walton, and then he got picked up by the NBA. So that was a good ending to that little story. Summary could have been just a little bit better.
That's true.
Your conclusion was good, and your tie back to Jenny and Claire was excellent. What goals were you trying to accomplish?
Goals? Well, I was definitely trying to check a lot of the boxes in the success thing.
Yeah.
Obviously, three stories, so that's good.
Yeah.
I felt like I did a good job establishing my credibility. I felt like I was pretty concrete. I had a lot of examples that I used. Not only did I use them, but I tried to use them in a, like I said that they were Kobe tall. I said that the guy was smaller than me. I tried to take it away from the statistical framework, as was mentioned in the book.
Good.
So I was just trying to apply a lot of the concepts.
Excellent. What was unexpected, or did you have something you designed in that was a little unexpected?
For me to start a story and not finish it at the very beginning, I felt was unexpected. I feel like a lot of those stories are good stories because they're unexpected. Walk-on brainy kids aren't supposed to play. If you play against the paper, you're not supposed to come back to college. You know, if you don't play in college, you're not supposed to play in the NBA. I felt like a lot of the stories were unexpected by nature.
I watched this sports program on HBO with Bryant Gumbel.
Oh, Real Sports with Bryant Gumbel is brilliant.
What's it called?
Real Sports with Bryant Gumbel.
Real Sports with
Very
Bryant Gumbel,
program.
Yeah. And they had a story of a young man that was a brilliant pitcher, and then he started throwing balls into the stands. And they have a name for it. I don't recall what it is. But he had to quit baseball, and then he got a second chance in the outfield. So, and he had a great arm, but I guess Steve Sachs did this a little for the Dodgers, would throw balls into right field and stuff. So this idea of, you know, getting a second chance in sports is a nice thing to see, because you have to really be on your game usually, or you're out of there. I would say you have a tendency to do this when you're speaking, so if you could plant your feet a little better and not when you come to walk and when you stand and deliver, not do, you'll see it when you watch yourself tonight on YouTube. But overall, you did an excellent job, David. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. Free country. People are dying in Syria and Iraq, so you have freedom and liberty. Enjoy it while you can.
Any chance you have a skateboard?
Glad to see that. I sure do. There you go. What are you turning in?
The policy brief.
Policy brief? Yes. Great. Okay. Good. Thank you. Yeah, good. Excellent. Overcrowding in prisons. Yeah, excellent. Okay.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome. Hat and all, huh? Okay, take care, Vincent. Vincent Van Gogh. Okay, volunteer, or do I go to the page? Okay, I'll go to the page.
Why don't you just randomly select one of those?
What?
Why don't you just randomly select one for
it? You can go like this?
Yeah.
Not
that right.
I almost knocked over your bottle. Sorry about that. Okay, you got randomly selected. So tell me where I find you on my page.
Round one, speaker one.
Don't tell me that. Speaker three. Joshua Kim Cruz.
Yes.
Okay. Give me a moment to put down your name. Okay, Joshua Kim Cruz, let's see what we got here. Yeah, right. Well, okay, let's do, I hate to do this, but yeah, let's do number one. And Joshua's going to speak on quote number one. Let me get you in focus. There you go. That says, some stuff can be fixed. Some stuff can't be. Deciding which is which is part of maturing. This was written by Lou Alcindor, who changed his name to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. So one more time, your quote for today to speak on is, some stuff can be fixed, some stuff can't be. Deciding which is part of maturing.
Hi, everyone. My name is Josh.
Hi, Josh.
Hello. And when I was 8 years old, I had my first experience and memory of me breaking a glass inside the house. Being the dramatic and emotional child that I was, I thought that my life was over and I packed a bag. Had I known that I could have simply called my mom, explained the situation, told her I wasn't hurt, but more importantly, cleaned up the mess that I made, I probably would have spent a lot less time trying to put everything in a trash bag. But given the chance, I wouldn't change anything of that situation at all, because I learned a really valuable lesson in that what I thought was a dire situation where all hope seemed to be lost was actually, in hindsight, just a situation I could have repaired with what now is just a couple dollars for a new glass. So today we're going to be looking at the quote, "Some stuff can't be fixed, some stuff can be," and deciding which is maturing from Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the legendary alumni from UCLA himself. And I agree with this quote, but believe a more expanded version should be along the lines of deciphering what is either changeable or inevitable, and the motion of accepting which is maturing in of itself. I mean that in the sense that if you're able to look past what's given at hand and be able to look at a bigger picture, something can actually, what seems to be dreadful, be in turn something that can help you in the future. And today I'm going to be showing you three examples as to how this shows true with regards to breakups, interviews, and the judicial system itself. So, to begin, breakups are unfortunately a common phenomenon with today's first world youth that range between teenage and young adults. According to Leah Rose Emily of Psychology Today, amongst the hundreds of people that she had interviewed, approximately about 40 reported that their first relationship had gone no more than 5 years. Unfortunately, breakups plague you like a bad song that doesn't stop playing in your head. When you want to go to sleep, it's the only thing that comes up. More so over, in the same article, it was quoted that upwards of 70% of people feel grief right after the initial shock and disbelief that the breakup actually happened. However, you may be asking, where is the good in all this? The same article actually reported that after a breakup, post-breakup is amongst the time where people have the biggest self-realization, the biggest time where people actually have the biggest movement to go work out again to make themselves feel better, because it releases the right amount of dopamine. So in a case where all seems lost, and unfortunately many people have like taken their lives over the time span of life, you can actually take something that would seem dreadful and think about it in the future and take what works into the next relationship. Moving on, we're going to talk about interviews and how taking the bad from an interview could potentially be good. So I think I speak for all of us here when I say that none of us have gone to an interview expecting the very best and thinking that, okay, 100% I'm going to start this day. Because most of the time, unfortunately, we either don't get the call back or that job isn't the biggest fit for us, which is quote on saying we didn't get the job. So people may ask, how can I possibly get good information out of something that possibly just roasted me? Well, according to Ryan Hesse from Lifehack, because there are similar questions that are asked from the proctors and because they are given to the applicant pools amongst the business world, one can literally take what worked, what didn't work in their past interview and apply it to any other interview in their lives. So people look back on what they wore, what they said, even the gestures that they did. What's to critique? Of course, the interviewing skills. Francis Haynes, who is a 25-year veteran of career development, stated that the most textbook play someone can do with regards to progressing through the business world is taking what worked in a past interview, applying those things, and not necessarily changing or getting rid of what didn't work, but altering and pivoting into what critiques the proctor may be applicable to. And finally, I will be talking about the judicial world and how that applies to taking the bad and the good and maturing from such. I'll be more specifically talking about slavery and how our nation grew more maturely as a society, per se. Given now that the look on slavery is obviously heinous in its own respect, we wouldn't have known that if not in for fact we had made the law to make slavery legal in the first place. Because it was made legal, we are able to make it illegal and heinous in that sense. Because it is one of the most obvious transgressions against human laws and human rights, We were able to think almost second nature as to how it can never be possibly the case that slavery should be good. And thus being able to fix something, and take something that is fixable and being able to mature from such. An example of how the judicial system today would work with respect to taking what can fix and maturing from such would be regards to how courts nowadays must have subject matter jurisdiction over a case in order to be able to apply their respectable decisions and pleas amongst a certain case. It will look upon past cases that have similar juries and judges and thereby implement what they think would be the appropriate response or approach to a given case. So with this, I feel like I have explained to you why when I was an 8-year-old, just having the mindset that the whole world crumbling down around me because a glass broke would be, it's essentially preposterous. It's really easy to think how the bad can be only in a situation when all else seems dim, when in reality, like, most of the things that we encounter can indeed be fixed and thus us mature from them. So without a doubt in the room, I believe that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's quote of how taking the good from, or being able to distinguish between what's fixable and non-fixable can essentially help mature us as a whole stands true. Thank you.
Thank you. What was the time?
6:37.
Thank you. Let's go over here.
Positive things.
Stand up for Jesus.
Well, my name is David. Your
Hi, David.
Beginning example was literally perfect. I don't know if I can think of a better story, you know, a little kid breaking a glass and freaking out about it to go along with this quote. That was, you know, top notch, spot on. Good job.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Eric.
Hi, Eric.
I like the speech. I felt that you could have a little more, like, eye contact, and I felt that, like, you were a little bit monotone the whole time. It didn't grasp my attention as much, but I thought the stories were good.
Thank you.
Okay, those are good comments, ones I subscribe to, and you'll be a more interesting speaker if you do have that vocal variety, okay?
Yeah, I know. I figured I could have worked more on the delivery itself, but
yeah,
just like not making eye contact and just trying to like think of those facts that I tried to cite was like kind of one of the playing parts.
Highest goal you had today was to get the content out of the speech. Okay, great. Well, gosh. Some stuff can be fixed, some stuff can't be. Deciding which is part of maturing, yeah. So, you talked about being a boy, which would be sort of an immature state, and you were looking back on it saying, had you been more mature, you would have worked that problem out. I guess it grabbed our attention well, so I guess it fulfilled the dynamism of a good intro, and you did tie back to it, so that was good. Your thesis preview was fine. You did tell us that you were going to talk about breakups, interviews, and the judicial system. I didn't get a very good significance statement, right? And I think you really want to sell this to the audience and tell them, you know, it takes a certain wisdom, it takes a certain maturity to know the difference between what can and cannot be changed, quote, fixed, whatever. And therein lies the essence of the quote. And I think I would have played it that way for your significance statement. On your main body. Two things I liked, and I'll talk about them. You treated this more like an extemp than an impromptu. Nothing wrong with that. You brought in information from Psychology Today, so you had extra credibility. So that was excellent. You weren't too abstract in this particular example. So that worked. And you talked about, you know, what people go through and what they get out of breaking up, and in retrospect what they learn. And I wish that you, in all three examples, had used more of the language of the quote in the middle and in the end of the quote, and to say, so, even though breaking up is hard to do, if you can learn from it and know that, you know, some part of your personality can change, some can't, and on you go and learn from that, then you'll have the wisdom and maturity to know what can and cannot be fixed. See, tie back to the quote a little more overtly. Your interview, yes, I like that. I thought that again was a great example, very relevant to the class who is probably looking for a job for the summer or for long term. I always tell my debaters after they have an interview to send a follow-up handwritten, not faxed, not emailed, letter saying, even if they reject it or not, could you tell me what qualities I could develop to be more desirable for your firm? And sometimes just the weirdness of getting a handwritten letter stands out, and some personnel directors will see that and take the person under their wing and help them get employment. So, and help them know what to change and what to fix and what they can't fix. So, just a little added thing to all the things you were saying you could learn from, you know, job interviews that fail and didn't work out. On your third reason, I'm just going to say it like this, Josh. It wasn't as clear as it could have been. When you watch it tonight, you're going to see that it was kind of flailed around a little in the content of it, and you didn't relate it very well to the quote. I didn't really see where precedent got mixed up into what can change and what can't change, unless you're saying you can't change it because it is a precedent or not. So that just was muddled to me, and it wasn't that clear. Your summary was good, your conclusion was good, and your tie back was excellent. On the stickiness of your speech, what was unexpected in here?
I can't really map out something that wasn't expecting. Did anything in particular stick out to you? Like, as much as I tried to make something like unexpected or twist out, I felt like just having such a concrete type of like quote and delivering it like straight, like kind of, I didn't have too much leeway in that sense.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. I would urge you to be creative about creating weird stuff, vocal variety, standing over there, standing on your head, changing your voice, doing something to create an energy point that's informational and significant to your speech. You want real heavy attention on it, because that's what that unexpected does for the audience and for you as a speaker. It gives you extra added attention and emphasis. See? Yeah. Credibility. You relied heavily on your quotes, which were good. You were credible. You seemed sincere as a speaker. Wasn't too abstract. And the stories were pretty good. Maybe if you added a little one of your own job interview of a situation, might have been good. But overall, a good job. Let's see, I would say for your life's work, for future communication, you need to really work on vocal variety and filling the room more with energy. And really try to get it up for, you know, your enthusiasm up so that you really shine when you speak, okay?
Thank you.
Okay.
I can go if you want.
Thank you. I appreciate that. See, I thought I was going to get a four-color pen out of this deal.
Did you? I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay, what page are you on, sir?
Same page. I think I'm speaker four.
Of round one?
Yeah.
Speaker four. Are you Eric or Aram?
Eric.
Okay, you're Eric. Eric Renzio?
Renslow.
That's an L?
Yes.
Right.
I never excelled in handwriting.
Renslow.
Okay, yes.
Got it. Okay, Eric Renslow, You are the fourth speaker, correct? Yes.
Yes, speaker four.
Speaker four. Oh. We have all these doubled up people. It's kind of unfortunate.
I think I signed up for that one first.
Oh, so you're first. Yeah.
And, okay. I'm saying before anyone, I didn't double up, someone else.
Yeah, okay, that's fine, yeah. So we'll give you a pass, yeah. Okay, let's see you do number three. A quote by Robert De Niro, who said, "I don't like to watch my own movies. I fall asleep in my own movies." And that's a quote by Robert De Niro, who says, "I don't like to watch my own movies. I fall asleep in my own movies."
Hello, everybody. My name is Eric.
Hi, Eric.
Hello, Professor Miller. Thank you for this class.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
As many of you may or may not know, Robert De Niro is a very famous movie actor. But let's take a step back for a minute. Let's say that you worked your, you know, many, many months, potentially years, on a movie. You're doing a movie, and then as soon as it comes out, you're sleeping. Like, personally, I just don't buy that. I don't think that people love to watch themselves. They love to watch their own movies, and I do not agree with this quote. I do not like to watch my own movies. I fall asleep in my own movies. And I will use three examples. I will use movies. I will use some reality shows such as Survivor and even The Bachelor. And I will also use real life such as Facebook, Instagram, and Snapchat. And the reason this is important is because I think this applies to life a little bit more broadly. That the quote, "I don't like to watch my own movies, I fall asleep in my own movies." And I'm going to try to connect that back to real life for my third example. So the first example is a movie. So during actual movies, I've done research on like extras or whatnot and what the movie filming process is like. And what actually happens in the movie is like you'll have a person there. He or she might talk to like a little stick with like a little, you know, potato thing that is supposed to, you know, be a giant dragon or whatever. And they spend the whole day saying like one line over and over again. And they'll be like, "Oh, you know, I will vanquish you. And then they say, I will vanquish you. And then they say, I will vanquish you. And they do a lot of different, like, takes on it, and everybody just keeps doing the same line. And they might film the last part of the movie in the beginning. And then they film, like, the middle part in the middle, and then they film the beginning and the end, and nobody really knows how it all connects. I mean, they may or may not have read the script, but they don't... It's not like a very sequenced thing, and they don't know what makes the cut or what doesn't. And I think it's very surprising to actually see, like, with all the CGI and all the whatnot, what actually shows up on the main screen. Like, for Fast and Furious, Paul Walker actually passed away before they filmed all of it. And they still had him doing all this amazing acting and whatnot, and there's no way that any of the other actors could have known all of what they did with him in the Magic CGI studios. So I just don't think you'd fall asleep when you don't know even know what's going to be on the big screen. The second argument I have is more, that was more fiction. Now I'm going to talk about more reality shows, such as Survivor. So for Survivor, they literally have 24 hours of footage every single day. To remind you, the quote is, I don't like to watch my own movies, I fall asleep in my own movies. So they have 24 hours of footage every single day. But the editors probably take maybe 30 minutes of that footage, and they decide to cut it and to make a narrative, and they cut it based on who makes it to the end, and they cut it based on, like, if who they want the villain to be and who they want the good guy to be. So if you're on that show, you might think you're the good guy the entire time, just so that when you watch it, you're the bad guy. They're like, oh, you know, they show your 1 minute of sabotaging, and they don't show your 23 hours and 59 minutes of being the good guy. Or, for example, on The Bachelor. The person, I mean, I have to admit, I guess I watched The Bachelor. It was only this one season, I swear. I don't usually watch The Bachelor. But they show this big fight between this very rich Miami girl and this, you know, other, you know, doctor person who always bragged about her master's degree. And they showed it, like, very prominently throughout the entire season. Apparently, according to some spoilers, there was another big argument between the person that won the show and the person that's going to be the next Bachelorette. And they were going at each other the entire time. But they entirely cut it from the filming because, you know, one of the person in the fight won and the other person is, you know, starring up their franchise the next time. So on one hand, they had, you know, these two fights and they show one prominently and they entirely cut the other one. So I don't know how you could fall asleep when you don't even know who you're going to be. Are you going to be the fight that shows up prominently? Are you going to be just the good guy throughout and they don't even show you? And my final thing to relate this back to life is life. So the quote, I don't like to watch my own movies, I fall asleep in my own movies. Let's take a look at Facebook, Instagram, or Snapchat. If you think about it, Facebook is kind of like a movie. You live your life 24 hours a day. You know how crappy your lives are. I mean, come on, you know, the student loans and whatnot. But, like, you maybe post, like, that one picture of you having fun. You know, like, oh, look, you know, I got an A on an exam, and you don't post the rest of your C minuses. Or you say, look at my vacation, like, I had so much fun, and you don't say that that's, like, your only vacation for the entire year. So this is, like, the movie. This is the cool part. And the rest of it is, like, the behind the scenes. And when you look at other people's, like, Facebooks, Instagrams, and Snapchats, that's all their movies. What would you rather like to see? A 24-hour feed of your friends going throughout their boring day? Or that little movie of their best snaps, their best Instagrams throughout the day, kind of in a narrative form, very, like, you know, fast-paced and interesting? You don't want to see the 24-hour behind the scenes. Just because you lived your life, you want to, like, project the important parts, the movie part. You don't want to do the 24-hour stuff. So I think that watching the movie is the best part. You actually get to see what makes the cut, the important parts of your life and whatnot. So, and to summarize, I have given you three examples of the quote, I don't like to watch my own movies, I fall asleep in my own movies. Movies, because, you know, you don't... It's very unrealistic when you film the movie, and it's much different when you're actually what comes up on the movie. Reality shows, because even though you get to experience all of it exactly the same, you don't know what makes the cut. Only like 1% probably shows up on TV. And then Facebook, Instagram, and Snapchat, because though that's kind of like the movie version of real life. Like, very few people make movies like Robert De Niro, but you kind of make your own little movies. And very few people want to see a 24-hour feed. They want to see the important parts. So to tie back, Robert De Niro is a very successful actor and whatnot, and I appreciate what he says because he probably has a lot of experience. But for most people, and I think even most actors, I don't think that really applies. That's probably the highlight of their life, is to watch their own movie. I very rarely think they fall asleep in it, unless, you know, perhaps they're very, very tired. Thank you.
Thank you. What was the time?
6:54.
Thank you. Let's see, where are we? Who hasn't spoken? You haven't spoken.
I'm not. Hello, I'm Marcos.
I'm Marcos.
Hey, Marcos. I liked your speech. I thought it was really good. I really liked how, like, the examples you gave, they really pulled in, like, my attention, and more so than other speeches. Especially when you mentioned The Bachelor, that just immediately gravitated towards your speech. So, yeah. I watched it too, so it's awesome.
Okay.
Yeah, but good job.
Solidarity.
Quite a revelation. How can he improve?
I thought it was a good speech, but I would cut the words and phrases you don't need. A lot of like, you know, I think there was like a whatchamacallit in there sometime, but I mean...
a bunch of what?
A whatchamacallit.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
Just kind of like words that don't necessarily hit, have like content, but
right.
It's just kind of like filler to like get to the next like idea. Which is, I get it, but like, if you want to like really refer like your point, then it's kind of just facts on that. But otherwise,
yeah, Eric, let's start with that one. It was a good speech. Don't get me wrong, but let's start with the fillers and the. And it's good that you're on YouTube tonight. You can see yourself and see. Watch yourself use the fillers. And my suggestion is when you practice in the future with a live person, ask them to raise their hand when you do the fillers, the likes, the you knows, the whatchamacallits, the empty phrases, so that you get out of the habit. And you need to develop a self-awareness that you're using these phrases excessively and try to lose them. It's not easy. You know, because this is a habit people have, that they use these fillers a good deal of the time, especially in private conversation. Well, I was intrigued to see what you were going to do with, I don't like to watch my own movies, I fall asleep in my own movies, Robert De Niro, because it's a... It's a quote that's there's not a lot to do there. And I guess the question I had in my mind is, why did he say that? And do you have a... could you speculate on why he said he falls asleep?
I looked it up and I didn't really see much context to it. Maybe he was just trying to
be humble.
Yeah, maybe there's some screening and he's just trying to be cool or something. But
yeah.
I didn't find much context besides
yeah.
just the floor.
Yeah, it seems to me that he's trying to be humble. You hypothesize in some of these that perhaps occasionally people are tired, but I guess he's trying to be humble. I think you're correct. And I can give you my own empirical example of somebody that co-wrote a screenplay that was made into a movie. I watched the dailies very intently. I watched the final product. I make it a requirement for my debate team to watch. So, and I watch it intently, even years later. So I don't think... I just don't buy that... I'm so cool. I don't watch my own movies. Yeah. So I agree with you on that. Now, on your significant statement of your application to life, I guess was kind of a stretch, but it was the best one can do with this quote. You first talked about movies and extras and lots of people saying lines a million ways, and so you never know how it's going to get edited, and that is true. That is very true, and things get cut out, and for example, we had written a whole area of the debate coach in my movie had trouble with alcoholism. We had a whole subplot on that, and you know, the powers to be thought it dragged the movie down, so you know, we lost 14 minutes of the alcoholism of the debate coach, you know, so if I didn't know that was going to get cut out till I went to the premiere. Mm-hmm. You know. Okay, so on your movies, that was a good one, and the Paul Walker thing was good. On the reality shows, you talked about Survivor with 24 hours of tape, and The Bachelor, which you sheepishly, I guess, admitted watching. I don't know why. It's entertaining, and it passes the time. You know, as many as any of these shows on TV do. But you did this all from the actor's perspective, not from the audience, and so that was very interesting. Yeah. So you kept it close in on the actors. You wanted to see how the fights came out, how the extras looked in their parts and so forth. Real life, I don't know if I buy your thing about Facebook and the other thing about a movie, but it was a little stretch to me, but it was a good try. Your summary and tieback were all good. You had a pretty simple message, which is to say, no, they don't fall asleep. What was unexpected?
I think, connecting it to real life, I think, was unexpected, and then also the topical references to the reality shows, and just the type of background knowledge of all how these things work, I didn't interpret it entirely literally. I tried to make it more apply to everyone.
Okay. How about working in the emotions of this and making people care emotionally about this subject or topic? What were your thoughts in pulling the emotions out of this subject? Yeah.
So, the reality shows, I figured that at least a couple people will have seen it, so I figured that they would be more interested after making the reference. And then also making it about the Facebook, Instagram, and Snapchat, even though it wasn't the best like example,
yeah,
I felt everybody, at least a lot of young people, could kind of relate to that.
Okay. All I would say, and then stories and more stories, I would say could have been helpful. I would say just remember to do your checklist of success when you've written an essay or put together a speech to make sure that you have a simple thesis and that you have something unexpected when you want to grab the attention of the reader or the audience, that you have credible sources that you cite, that you're credible yourself, that you're not too abstract, that you're always concrete, you pull some emotional dimension to this to get the audience to care, and that you have stories and more stories. What do you think was your connoisseur goals of what you were trying to accomplish speaking wise?
I think my goal for this speech was to make it long enough because I didn't think there was a lot of material, but
yeah,
and also to make it interesting because it's a pretty simple quote. And to move, next time we'll definitely be eliminating the fillers. It happens here and there, but it definitely does pop up unexpectedly.
Yeah. Okay, well, I think you accomplished that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
Appreciate the class.
I appreciate you coming to class, Eric.
Thank you.
You'll go next. Great. tell me where I find you.
I think it's on the second page, seventh speaker.
Seventh speaker. Well, that says Ryan, so that could, unless you changed your gender. Are you Ryan?
No, third page, sorry.
What?
Third page, seventh speaker. Yeah.
Sabrina or Laurel?
Serena.
Oh, Serena, that's a R. Looks like a B. Okay, Serena, W?
Yes.
What's the W stand for?
Wing.
Okay, rock and roll.
Do I just pick which one I want?
You want to know which one you're going to speak by then? Anyone!
Oh,
awesome. No, all of them!
Wait,
give me a moment.
Well, oh, I thought you were letting me pick. I was really excited. Can I pick?
I want you to speak on number one. I try to give people a different way of looking at their surroundings. That's art to me by Maya Lin. I repeat, I try to give people a different way at looking at their surroundings. That's art to me.
So surfers are oftentimes known as stoners, and for a surfer named Hawk Hulana, this statement is actually partially true. Because the way she practices is by dragging large 50-pound boulders across the ocean floor. Now, while I can't even jog on dry land without seeing visions of my fast-approaching unconsciousness, Hawk Hulana shows what a different perspective can do. But this different perspective came because she knew that training on dry land like other surfers wasn't the most efficient for her. Rather than doing yoga or other cardio, she decided to drag this rock along the ocean floor to increase her stamina. And it's this very exact idea of opening up our perspective that was present in the quotation today. I tried to give people a different way of looking at their surroundings. That's Art to Be by Maya Lin. And what Maya Lin is saying is that it's important to have a different approach to things. I agree with her perspective, and I do believe that this is significant, because when we are open-minded and when we look at things through different viewpoints, can we see more opportunities and get a different perspective on situations. So today, I will examine this quotation through three different perspectives. First, what happens when we open up our perspective? Second, how that allows us to gain worldly success? And finally, how looking at things through different perspectives can also help us raise awareness. To start off, we can first take a look at why it's important for us to open up our perspective. And through that, we will take a look at the Moschino Barbie doll commercial to examine how their different perspective allowed them to gain success. 2 years ago, Moschino and Mattel partnered up and decided that they were going to introduce their Moschino Barbie through an advertisement. But rather than staying with the same closed-minded perspective of featuring multiple young girls playing with Barbie dolls, they decided that they were going to broaden up their perspective. So, they decided that they were going to portray a boy for the first time in over 50 years. And in their advertisement, a boy was shown instead of girls playing with this Barbie doll and declaring it was fierce. Within 1 hour, this Barbie doll completely sold out. And it just goes to show you how unprepared Moschino and Mattel were for this success. The reason for this is because rather than portray just girls in their commercial and target their audience to a select amount of people, they opened it up by portraying boys. And through the Moschino Barbie doll advertisement, we can see that it is important for us to open up our perspectives because we are opened up to more opportunities. Next, we can also take a look at an individual named YKK and see how his broadened perspective allowed him to gain worldly success. So, if you take a look at your zipper, preferably after the speech, you might notice three letters on it, YKK, for Yoshido Kogyo Kabushiki Kaisha, which we will refer to as YKK for lack of time. What set this man apart is that he decided that he was going to make his zipper company different. Rather than stay with the same narrow-minded approach that other zipper companies took, he decided that he was going to take a different approach. To elaborate, during this time period, many zipper companies only focused on quantity. They didn't care about the quality of a zipper, but rather tried to produce millions of zippers per day. And as a result, their product began to fail. So what YKK decided to do was create zippers that were focused on quality. And by doing so,